Welcome aboard the BK Escape Pod. That's right, it's the augmented and bionic podcast version of the live show you can hear Saturdays from 10 a.m. till 12 p.m. Eastern on 100.3 FM and AM 1450 WBHF Radio. You can stream the show live there Saturdays at WBHFradio.org or on the free Tunein app. Look out, here we go. Oh, and by the way, if you hear me give out a telephone number, don't call because this is a rebroadcast and our janitor Charlie will answer the phone, and believe me, you don't want to talk to him. He's an ornery little cuss. Hey, it's BK on the air here on AM 1450 and 100.3 FM WBHF. We are live in the studio. Alan is out today, and I'm here to dispense nostalgic geekiness talk radio as usual. Every Saturday morning, the chair is propped up against the door, and no one can get in, so nobody can throw me off. With me this morning is Chance. Chance is here, though. You didn't have any prior engagement today, did you?
No. Happy to be here. How are you, BK?
Good. Chance is here. We're going to have a lot of fun today. I've got so many stories coming up today. We're going to hear from Channel Star Wars. We're going to hear from the Golden Rage of TV, which is Pat McCormick. We'll hear from him. And we'll talk about everything nostalgic, geekiness and stuff. We'll have Flash the Audience at the bottom of the hour and have a good time with that. Where's my cell phone? Did I put it back there? Oh, I think it's in my pocket. Because it's usually my only – I got a clock here in the studio. We've got to make sure I know what time it is. Yeah, I'm going to turn it on silent before anybody – all this professional radio stuff in here, behind-the-scenes stuff. So,
and what we don't have this week is a Loki update.
No
Marvel Universe
Loki's
streaming
done.
Right now. That's
Loki's
right.
Done. But did you know that reminds me, there was a show that ABC did. ABC did a show called The Inhumans.
Yes.
Do you remember The Humans on ABC?
They yes. did
it. It was Marvel's first really flop.
Yeah.
Because it came out, you know, they were like, well, you know, I think Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. was done. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden ABC did The Inhumans
right.
with, you know, Crystal and Black Bolt. And,
right.
And they were living on the moon. And everyone... No one liked it, and I watched The Inhumans. Did you get to see it?
Nope.
It's streaming on Disney Plus now, along with all the other Marvel stuff.
Good to know.
I actually liked it. It was actually very well done, and I don't know why it flopped. It was another Marvel installment. It was a. I never read the comic book The Inhumans.
I did. They debuted in the Fantastic Four.
And it wasn't Crystal, the lady, the Medusa girl with the red
right.
hair. Wasn't she a part
she
of the Fantastic Four for
no,
a while?
She was a villain. She was in the Frightful Four.
Right, but who am I thinking
Medusa.
About? Medusa, yeah. But who joined the Fantastic
Flowing
Four for a while?
Hair.
Crystal joined the Fantastic Four for a while.
She did.
She was part of the group for a while.
Yeah.
So if you've never seen The Inhumans, you may not like it. Well, give it a shot, because it was a Marvel show that didn't make it, and it was only for, like, maybe not even a season. And I don't know what everyone's problem with it was, because it was actually a really good show. But you're right. Loki did wind up. The finale of Loki came along, and we talked about that last weekend.
And but, Black Widow,
and
the
you
movie.
And I, you and I went to see Black Widow, and I don't know if anyone's seen it yet or not. But if you get a chance, and I've said that before, go see it in a theater. Don't stream it. I mean, you can stream it later when it's with your Disney Plus membership that you have already. You don't have to pay extra for it when it gets down to where you can watch it like that. But don't pay for it online. Go see it at the theater and help out them poor theater owners.
Well,
know?
A lot of people did.
Great.
Had big box office numbers, but I was disappointed to see Space Jam 2 knock it off its perch at number one, and that movie was terrible. That is on HBO Max, by the way, Space Jam 2.
What is the fascination of mixing basketball with Bugs Bunny and Warner Brothers? I never got that. Didn't like the first one, and I don't know how those two go together. They just don't go together.
Yeah, I won't totally hate on it.
It's crazy.
But it reminded me on the positive side of Who Framed Roger Rabbit from 1989.
Yeah.
I like it when they have live action and animation.
Right.
Live action meaning real people actors.
And Who Framed Roger Rabbit, you know, did that pretty well back in the day. So it's always fun.
The first Space Jam was good. Did you see the original?
I saw like the first 30 minutes of it, and I just didn't. I mean, I wasn't into it. I think that was later on when I was more of an adult. There's that fine line.
We're never going to be adults, Barry.
Well, not technically. You're right. We're not going to be adults. But there's that fine line of when you stop in that early 80s, when I actually kind of stopped watching kiddie cartoons, and then eventually didn't watch them anymore. And that's the fine line between maybe your age and mine or Alan's age and mine, because Alan and I are like 4 years apart, so he was still watching cartoons in 1983 and 4, and I'd already kind of stopped, because he's a Transformers fan, but I never watched the Transformers.
Wait a minute, so you mean to tell me you didn't watch He-Man and the Masters of the Universe?
I did not watch He-Man. That was the last Filmation show that I did not watch.
By the way, it's had a reboot on Netflix, and of all people, Mark Hamill, who played Luke Skywalker, voices Skeletor, the villain.
And when all that
in the new version.
And the He-Man to me was a little more of a kiddie show. I think the last show that I watched, and I talked to Eric Harris, listener online about this. Eric's a big fan of He-Man and the Masters of the Universe. I love the motion picture with Frank Langella as Skeletor. I thought it was very well done and fun movie.
1987, I believe. Yeah.
But when He-Man came out, I had just watched a cartoon in 1981 before He-Man, which was kind of the precursor, and I thought it was a little better, called Black Star. And I thought Black Star was like, wait a minute, they just kind of took Black Star and took him a step further and made He-Man. But I actually thought Black Star was the better cartoon, and I only think it ran
the 80s He-Man
seasons.
Though, Barry. Not to interrupt you, I'm sorry. It reminded me of the parody in Saturday Night Live, the ambiguously gay duo. Not that there's anything wrong with that.
Well,
the way it was drawn.
They weren't animated like that. You're right about that, yeah. So it's BK on the air. I got a story here. I don't know if I should do this now or wait. Well, I'll do this before we go to the break. Let's talk about Cartersville Bicycle Service and Supply.
Oh, yeah.
And now there's a new bicycle shop right here in Cartersville. They're not brand spanking new, but they're new to a lot of people. It's called Cartersville Bicycle Service and Supply. They've got a great deal going for you right now, only for the month of July, so check this out. You can buy an adult bicycle at regular cost and get a kid's bike for 50% off. That includes all bicycles with 20-inch wheels and smaller. Both bicycles must be purchased at the same time. And remember, Cartersville Bicycle offers maintenance and repair of all bicycles as well as parts and accessories. Whether you're a veteran rider or just starting out, Cartersville Bicycle has what you need to get out there and enjoy the roads and the trails of wherever you want to go. Stop in and see the shop. They're located at the corner of West Avenue and South Tennessee Street, and they're open 7 days a week from 7:30 a.m. till 4 p.m. Call them at 470-315-BIKE. That's 470-315-2453, BIKE. See how they did that? Or you can search Cartersville Bicycle on Facebook. Chance and I went over there to check them out a few weeks ago, and there are some nice folks over there. And you commented when you walked in, you did your best Robert Duvall. Chance walked in and went, oh, I love the smell of fresh bicycle tires in the morning. That was great when you walked in. You smell those rubber bicycle tires. It's kind of cool.
I can't think of a better way to get in shape and a more fun way to get in shape than to get on a bicycle old school.
Well, I can think of
with a helmet on, of course.
I can think of a few better ways to get in shape, but I can't mention them on the radio.
This is a family show, Barry.
That's right.
It's your show. Remember your own rules.
That's right. About my own rules. Yeah,
we're governed by the FCC.
That's right. It's BK on the air. We'll be back.
We'll return after these announcements.
We're lost. My fault, but you...
Nita!
Food? Yes, crunchy food. C-3POs.
New Kellogg's C-3POs. Twin rings phase together for a crunchy new force at breakfast.
Yeah, the force is with us.
A delicious part of this nutritious breakfast.
On day!
Well, of course. How much?
Oh, my. C-3POs, a new force at breakfast.
It's a beautiful day for digital derby, ladies and gentlemen. Tiny Heel starts out cautiously. He jams his car to second gear, now third. He's really moving. The traffic is tight, but Tiny Heel's in the lead. Look out, Tommy! Too bad. Tiny Heel's out of the race. Tommy, you had a rough time out there. What happens now? Will you retire?
Retire? I'm only 8 years old.
Oh, yeah.
Batteries not included. Digital Derby Auto Raceway comes complete with lap counter and timer by Tomy.
Never fear, Smith is here.
Hey, we're back. It's BK on there. Let's go to Chance because he's got some great stuff coming on later in the program today. I'm going to let you just give a little tease after the 11:30 Eastern segment when we come back. What? Just to give everybody a little idea of what you are going to be talking about today. Chance,
what am
Bartels.
I going to be talking about,
yeah.
Barry King? Well, I will tell you. An Amazonian goddess turned 70 today.
I know who you're talking about.
Yes, the luscious Linda Carter.
You know what I need to find? I need to cue up the time that she sang a Kiss song with Kiss on her on that variety show.
Oh,
that's
right
what
on.
I should find. I was thinking about playing the Wonder Woman theme, but I'm like, maybe I should play that instead. I'll look for it.
Do that. So we're going to celebrate Linda Carter a little bit. Oh, yeah. And then also we've got some people to celebrate who have birthdays tomorrow and Monday. And I don't want to give away who it is, but it's people that everybody loves. And I have some anecdotes about these people. And also I've got my standard old nostalgic word or expression of the week, snack of the week, internet BS of the week, and other surprises. Now, Barry.
When you say BS, you mean Barbara Streisand, right?
Yeah, that's it. We're a family
just
show.
Just to be clear, yeah, that's right.
I don't want to telegraph my punch, but I'll give you a hint about the snack of the week. I usually talk about carb-infused chips and things like that,
right.
Bugles, sour cream and onion Doritos.
Right, which I haven't tried, by the way. I need to try those.
This is a candy. And it's a candy you really can't find anymore, but it's a name brand, and it is delicious. But I discovered you actually can still order it virtually online from the number one virtual online retailer that I don't want to mention and give a free plug to. I think the guy that started it went into space the other day.
He did, yeah.
Hint, hint. And that was pretty cool, wasn't it? Even though the ship was kind of phallic, wasn't it?
Was his name Jeff Bezos?
Bozo. No, Jeff Bozo.
Jeff Bozo.
Yeah.
Is that his name? Okay. Okay.
No, but that was pretty impressive, though, I must say. I mean, no problem, right? You just on a lark, you want to go into space with your friends.
You sound like Ed Grimley there for a second. This is what I must say. Was that Martin Short?
Yeah, Martin Short from SCTV that we talked about with Walt.
That's right. I keep forgetting he started on SCTV.
Oh, you have
a lot of the other Canadian guys from SNL. Yeah, the phone ringing. Let's go to it. Hey, it's BK on the air. Who's this? You're on the air, too.
Hello, Barry.
Hey, good morning, Eric. How are you doing there, buddy boy?
You started this early with me.
I started what early with you?
I don't like this.
You mean the whole He-Man thing?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I mean, I know you love He-Man and the Masters of the Universe, but I always thought Black Star was a better show than He-Man.
But you say you like the movie, right? Now see?
What?
That's why your wife needs to put you in the hole.
What, because I like Masters of the Universe?
Tell you about that.
The movie was exciting. It was awesome. The soundtrack was great. Frank Langella as Skeletor, he should have won an Academy Award for that. He was awesome.
That movie.
Oh, come on. That was a great movie.
He was a terrible Perry White, though.
Yeah.
In the 2006 Superman Return.
Well, Lord, don't get me started on that one.
Unfortunately, He-Man and the Masters of the Universe, the cartoon from Filmation, that's when I had stopped watching cartoons at that point because I was all grown up at that point. I didn't want to watch it.
Now that I watch it now.
It's kind of juvenile.
I'm not going to say that.
Right. But don't you agree? Did you, Eric, watch Black Star in 1981? You saw Black Star too, right?
I was only born in 1983, man.
I know, but have you not went back and since watched Black Star already?
Yeah, and I just don't.
I thought it was the precursor to He-Man. They kind of took Black Star and built on it kind of a little bit. Same themes came up.
No.
Well, you watch Black Star again. I think you need to check it out again. Well, all right. Man, we're running out of time, so call me later if you want to, okay?
All right,
Eric, talk to you later. Bye. Yeah, that's right. I always thought that Black Star was kind of precursor to He-Man. I really did. I don't know why. I mean, it's just something that I thought as far as TV shows go. Let's go check in with Pat McCormick in the Golden Rage of TV.
Greetings, fellow classic TV fans. In October of 2020, I had the distinct honor of inducting the great Mel Blanc into the Voiceover Actor Hall of Fame, which is housed at the historic Orinda Theater here in Northern California. The well-deserved honor went to this fine actor who, for the better part of two decades, verbally animated many of the beloved characters for the Warner Brothers' Merry Melodies and Looney Tunes. Well before being adapted to television, the animated shorts first appeared in movie houses during the 1930s. And 40s. As such, you may be surprised that a handful of the specific episodes actually won Academy Awards, and it just so happens that every one of the main characters were voiced by Mel. Introduced in 1945, Pepe Le Pew starred in the 1949 Oscar-winning cartoon titled For Scent, A Mental Reasons. They would often title Pepe's cartoons with verbal twists which pertained to his odorific persona. Tweety Bird was introduced in 1941 along with his nemesis, Sylvester the Cat, who made his debut in 1939. They co-starred in two more Academy Award-winning pieces, specifically Tweety Pie in 1947 and 1957's Birds Anonymous. Speedy Gonzales was the title of the 1955 winner. It not only introduced the new classic character, but also co-starred Sylvester. This meant that cartoons featuring Sylvester the Cat won the most Oscar statues of all. In 1958, a short titled Nighty Night Bugs, Bugs Bunny that is, won another Oscar. And speaking of bugs, according to the Guinness Book of World Records, since his initial appearance in 1940, that wascally wabbit has been in more films than any and all other popular cartoon characters, including Mickey Mouse. In part due to the late, great Mel Blanc, Bugs Bunny even has his very own star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. This is Pat McCormick with your retro TV trivia from the Golden Rage of TV. You can also find me on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram at Golden Rage of TV, and on Twitter at Golden Rage of TV1. And now back to BK on the air.
Thank you, Pat. I thought I saw a putty tat. That's great. Hey, boy, Mel was the man of a thousand.
Talked about him in my segment a couple weeks ago.
It was incredible.
Anniversary of his death, sadly.
And a lot of people forget that he, I don't know why they forget. I forget sometimes that he was the voice of Barney on the Flintstones. I mean, that wasn't Warner Brothers. That was Hanna-Barbera. But he wasn't locked into one group.
No,
you know, to do voices for and stuff,
and of course, so Twiggy and Buck Rogers. I talked about that before.
Yeah, Who did they replace Mel with in Buck Rogers?
I do not know. No one that's memorable. He was terrible.
Oh, he was
totally
terrible.
Changed the voice and the characterization of Twiggy the robot.
He was, and I have no idea why they changed it. And the fans didn't like it.
No, they brought Mel Blanc.
They brought him back. But there was somebody else that Mel was doing. I was fascinated, and I've said this before. Mel Blanc, not only is the man of a thousand voices, how hard would it be, number one, to come up with all those voices? You know how hard that must be, and talented he must have been. How hard is it to, in the episode where Elmer's hunting both Daffy and Bugs, you know the one I'm talking about?
Oh, yeah.
Rabbit hunting, duck season. Well, there's one, I don't know if it's that one, but it's one of the shorts where he actually has to do, Bugs Bunny puts on Daffy's bill, duck bill, and he has to do Daffy's voice like Bugs Bunny doing Daffy's voice. How schizophrenic do you have to be?
You read my mind. It's so scary how much we're alike. I was going to call him a schizo.
To do that.
Yeah, I was going to call him a schizo.
He's got voices in his head.
Yeah.
How crazy do you have to be?
Multiple personalities.
Crazy do you have to be?
No, he's a genius. There's a difference.
Yeah.
He was a freaking genius.
It's incredible. So we got all that coming up on the program. We actually got a lot of stuff to talk about today. The hits just keep on coming on Indiana Jones, the Indiana Jones 5 production over in England. You know, Harrison Ford got hurt. And so I don't know exactly if how many action sequences are in Indiana Jones, because there better be a lot of them, because there's been yet another injury on the set of Indiana Jones, the latest one that they're doing they're filming over.
Ooh,
there.
Tell us about it, Uncle Barry, the break.
We'll talk about it when we come back. We're going to flash the audience, though, when we come back with the news, the weird, the strange, and the bizarre. There's a Game of Thrones solo actress moving to Marvel. And I've also heard a rumor that Henry Cavill, or Cavill, that plays Superman, has talked to Marvel about being in something. So we may talk about that, too. I don't know. Everybody's jumping ship. Hey, Michael Keaton went to D.C. So did Michelle Pfeiffer.
Yeah.
You know, they're all D.C. actors. Catwoman and Batman. And he's even come in back as Batman, too. It's BK on the air.
To say that you behave childishly is an insult to children everywhere.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
You want to go to the moon? Do you want to go to the moon?
Why trust moments like these to anything else? Introducing Kodak Videotape. It captures the sights and sounds of every moment with color that's beautifully accurate, unmistakably Kodak.
Beam me up, Mr. Spark.
When the moment means more, tape it and keep it on Kodak Videotape.
Give it up! Podcast Magazine presents The Hot 50 Countdown.
Hi, it's Rob Actis, host of the Podcast Magazine Hot 50 Countdown. Join me as I count them down from 50 to number 1, the top 50 podcasts in the land as determined by you, the podcast fans. From true crime, society and culture, self-help, health and fitness, science, and every podcast category in between. The Hot 50 Countdown is here.
And don't forget to vote for BK on the Air as one of your favorite podcasts at podcastmagazine.com.
You're listening to BK on the Air. This is Mrs. BK, and I'm not listening now because, well, I sleep in every Saturday morning, but I'll catch him later on the BK Escape Pod podcast. Now, back to that man of mine, BK on the Air. Mwah.
Thank you, baby. It's Mrs. BK. And before I get home, she has my pipe and slippers all ready for me when I walk into the house and everything's fine on a Saturday afternoon. I'm kidding. That's a lie.
No, you're
she's
a
listening.
Very,
that is not true. She
you're a lucky man.
She does not do that. That's a joke. I swear that's a joke because she won't listen until I say something like that. Then she'll be listening.
Of course.
She has spider sense.
Of course.
She has spider sense. She'll be listening when I say the most inappropriate thing. And that's right. We're back. It's BK on the air here. Beautiful day here in Cartersville. Sunny. I don't know where you are, but it's beautiful and sunny where we are outside the studio windows. But it's time that we flash the audience of the news, the weird, the strange, and the bizarre. Oh, look at that. I got the first news. From EPI, a Canadian YouTuber and inventor earned a second Guinness World Record when he and his team created the world's brightest outsized flashlight. Listen to this. James Hobson, founder of Hacksmith Industries and creator of the Hacksmith channel on YouTube, posted a video showing off the supersized flashlight, which shines at a record-breaking... Do you have some flashlights at home?
I do.
You know, some and they gauge the brightness by lumens. You know, you can have a flashlight that's 100 lumens or, you know, 1,000's pretty bright, 1,000 lumens pretty bright. I think the 4,000 or 5,000 one are the big spotlights that you can go out, you know, in the woods with or something like that. This one has 501,031 lumens. That's bright. That's bright. The Hacksmith team's Night Bright 300 flashlight contains 300 LED bulbs. Guinness World Record says the most powerful commercially available flashlight, the Emallant MS-18, contains only 18 LEDs. The team said the Night Bright 300 contains 50 boards, which each have 6 LED bulbs, and the boards are connected to drivers that are all powered by a single battery. The inventors say they used a Fresnel reading magnifier, I don't even know what that is, to center the light and create a focus beam after their initial build resulted in multi-directional light being projected around the workshop. I wonder if they had to wear a welder's eye protection when they turn that thing on. That had to be bright. The team uses a Crookes radiometer. I don't know what any of this is. I'm sure someone in science knows what all these things are. That's a tool that uses a high-powered fan to measure the power of light waves, and the intensity of the light from the Night Bright 300 caused the radiometer to explode. It caused that device to blow up.
You know who would know?
The science museum. Yeah, and people smarter than me, which is usually everybody. The Hacksmith team previously set a world record when they created the world's first retractable proto lightsaber. They're the ones that built the working lightsaber
that
can actually cut through things and stuff like
right.
that. So yeah, isn't that cool? I mean, I wouldn't mind having that one, but I don't know if I could turn it on in the house.
That's true.
Could you imagine being in the house at night and then turning that on in the living room? Your neighbors would go, what's going on? They've opened a portal in that house to another dimension.
And LEDs, I have two pinball machines, and a lot of people replace the standard bulbs with the LEDs, and I don't like it. They're too bright.
They're too bright.
But
they
last
right.
longer, but I still have the old
it
school bulbs in my machines.
It doesn't look like it should, the classic way that we remembered. You're right.
It really doesn't. Now I've got the next news.
Flash away, buddy. We don't have a webcam in here. Go ahead.
Flash what?
Sorry.
Police in Maine said no one was injured on the ground or in the air when a plane lost its landing gear and the strut with tire and wheel landed on a golf course fairway.
Do you mind telling me what this is all about, mister?
The Gorham Police Department revealed Wednesday evening that the landing gear fell from a privately owned twin-engine Piper Navajo plane that had been intending to land at Portland International Jetport. The strut with tire and wheel landed on the fairway of the seventh hole at Gorham County Club's golf course.
Wow.
Police said the plane aborted its landing in Portland and returned to MacArthur Airport in Islip, New York, and was able to safely execute a belly landing after the Tuesday incident.
Uh-oh, I had a squirrel moment where I hear a word and it reminds me of something else. You know, like squirrel. You know, you get distracted. What? That happens to us all the time, or we wouldn't have a podcast or a radio show. You know, last show we were on, you'd brought up SCTV on the show earlier.
Second City Television.
Right, and you said, you remember the bit... Because we were talking about Christopher Cross, and somebody was playing, I don't know if it was Dave Thomas or whoever, was playing Christopher or Rick Moranis.
It was Rick Moranis.
They were playing Christopher Cross recording in the studio, Ride Like the Wind. So when Christopher Cross recorded that song, every now and then Michael McDonald would just pop in with some background vocals.
That was Rick Moranis.
And Rick Moranis would just come up, he was playing Michael McDonald, and he would just come up every then and just say his line and then sit back down.
A long way to go.
such a long way to go.
He would sit down. You could do Michael McDonald.
Oh, yeah.
When he would do it, he'd sit back down like he's taking a break because he only needs him for those things.
Right, and he would rush to get back to the mic when his line came up.
So again. Michael McDonald, that's cool. But I remember the other bit on SCTV. Now, you're a big SCTV fan, as I was, because to me, at the time, and I still think to this day, SCTV was a much funnier show than Saturday Night Live. I don't know why I was a much bigger fan.
Great satire. Of SCTV. Great cast. They're Canadians.
Right. All the people from Saturday Night Live were kind of from Second City Television Canada anyway.
Toronto.
They all knew each other.
Right.
But the other bit that they did.
John Candy.
Let's see if you remember this one.
All right.
I don't know who was playing him. Maybe it was Dave Thomas. He was doing.
Wendy's hamburger
no,
place.
No, not just right. He was doing another one of those weird in recordings, recording a song, and he was recording Richard Harris's MacArthur's Park. Did you see him doing that one?
Yeah, yeah.
And he would sing his part, MacArthur's Park is melting. Then in the middle of the song, there's this long instrumental. And he is, when the instrumental kicks in, he goes back and like lays down. That's just waiting for the instrumental to stop, and he comes back and does the rest of the lyrics. That reminded me of that one, too. And when you said MacArthur in that story, that
all the stuff's
me
on YouTube,
part.
And they did the best Jeopardy parody on SCTV.
They did.
And you know who played Alex Trebek in that?
Was it
Levy.
Eugene Levy?
Eugene Levy.
Yeah. Who had the most sculpted hair? He had like slick backed weird frizzy weird hair.
And all the contestants were morons. That was the bit. And he got frustrated and more and more frustrated and angry.
If you've never seen it, go on YouTube and look up SCTV Halfwits. Halfwits was
ooh in stereo.
It's hilarious. I got the next news. From UPI, the Florida Highway Patrol said a section of the interstate was closed when a crash involving a dump truck loaded with, what do you think it was loaded with?
Manure?
Cow turd.
Yes, it was loaded with manure.
That was a guess. I
caused
didn't read the story.
Poop to spill onto the roadway. The FHP said the dump truck was involved in a crash with a semi truck at mile marker 198 in the northbound lanes of Interstate 95 near Rockledge in Brevard County on Tuesday. No one was injured in the crash, but the dump truck's load of cow manure spilled out onto the road.
Cow turd.
Making for a messy situation for cleanup crews. I'll bet. I'd rather clean up anything than that. You know, beer. Water, soap.
Horse manure smells worse than any type I've ever encountered in my life.
It does. I mean, and I know cow manure is used as a fertilizer, but you know,
eat?
It's just different. Traffic was being diverted from the interstate onto Fisk Boulevard until lanes could be reopened. So they obviously had a problem with
cow turd,
with horse manure, with horse manure falling out on the interstate, which is fantastic.
So, I've got the next
maybe
news.
Not so much, I don't know. Do you now? Okay, go ahead.
What maybe Michelangelo's thumbprint has been found on a small wax statue that he created 500 years ago. Holy Buck Rogers, Batman. Museum experts at London's Victoria and Albert Museum found the mark pressed onto the dark red figurine, which was a sketch for a larger unfinished marble sculpture. Titled A Slave, the figurine depicting a naked figure with an arm across its face was part of the Renaissance master's preparations for Pope Julius II's elaborate tomb in Rome.
See, this is a fascinating story.
A lot of stuff
isn't that cool?
Pronunciate correctly, too, I might add. It's an exciting prospect that one of Michelangelo's prints could have survived in the wax, one of the Victoria and Albert Museum's curators said. Senior curator Pita Matur is quoted as saying in a BBC press release, quote, such marks would suggest the physical presence of the creative process of an artist, unquote. Michelangelo destroyed many of his preparatory works. The proposed statue was just one of over 40 life-size figures planned for the Pope's tomb, though plans were later greatly reduced. The sketch model is believed to have been created between 1515 and 1519. I assume that's AD and not BC.
It should be, yeah. Wow. Al and I are always joking about how we can't find anything valuable in our basement or buried in our backyard.
Like a copy of the U.S. Constitution behind a
I don't want them checking my backyard and what buried out there. They may find some stuff that I buried. It's BK on there.
I'm Gil Gerard. I'll be starring this fall as Buck Rogers in the 25th century. From the moment I arrived in the 25th century, everybody made me feel right at home. There were nights when I would just marvel at all the mysterious heavenly bodies. Well, here's to the future.
Spread your wings. In the new 1980 Thunderbird, with exciting options for the 80s, like the first keyless push-button entry system, like this dazzling array of electronic magic, fuel readout, road speed, warning lights, and Thunderbird offers another remarkable engineering breakthrough, the first and only automatic overdrive transmission option built in America. Spread your wings in a better idea for the 80s.
This is Houston. Say again, please.
Houston, we have a problem.
You're listening to BK on the Air. Now back to a guy who put me through a lot of pain in childbirth. I'm his mother, I should know, but I love him anyway. It's BK on the Air.
I didn't put her through any pain when I was a teenager, though, like some teenagers do.
Boy,
it was just when I was a kid, a little baby. That's the only time.
I can't believe my parents didn't dump my butt. All the trouble I got into with fireworks and everything else.
Really?
Oh, my Lord.
Is there other stuff you need to tell me off the air?
There is.
Oh, okay.
There is.
Well,
I'll sit down on the couch.
Look out. I got the last news. A Florida woman was arrested Monday after authorities say she was caught skinny dipping in a random homeowner's pool. The man who lives, and I thought, why can't that happen at my pool, at my house? Well, number one, I don't have a pool. And number two, when you saw a picture of the woman, you're like, no. The man who lives at the residence told Charlotte County Sheriff's deputies that he thought something was amiss when he found clothing strewn across his area of his pool there. And he spotted the naked stranger in his pool, police say. Police identified the alleged skinny dipper as Heather A. Kennedy, 42 years old. Responding deputies claimed Kennedy was confrontational and resisted arrest. She was taken to the Charlotte County Jail, where they say she refused to tell them her name. They must have, because they have it for the report here eventually. They said they were able to identify her. You're not going to believe this, by the way. Listen to this. They were able to identify her by previous jail booking photos.
Oh, no, I thought you were going to tell me a birthmark or something.
You mean she's done something in the past?
Yeah.
She's facing charges of trespass and resisting an officer without violence.
I'd like to see her mugshot.
How do you resist an officer without violence? No, I'm not going to do that.
No.
You just don't get physical. I guess that's how you do it. I don't know. 770-386-1450 is our number. By the way, if you want to call in and join in on the wonderful fun that we like to do here on BK on the Air every Saturday, 770-386-1450. I have a story here. The hits just keep on coming when it comes to the Indiana Jones film. Now, we know a couple of weeks ago, or was it earlier this month, Harrison Ford got injured filming on the Indiana Jones set.
And Big time.
Somebody needs to check him out, by the way, because, you know, keep him away from airplanes.
Yeah.
And watch him on the set, get some insurance on him, or get him a handler or something like that, because Harrison's prone to that. Didn't he get hurt on filming The Phantom Menace, too?
He did.
Not The Phantom Menace.
No, on...
It was The Force Awakens.
Force Awakens.
How could I mix up those two?
Part of the Millennium Falcon set fell on him.
Yeah.
The door fell on him and hurt his back.
How does that happen? You know, how does that happen?
Now, how's he going to crack his whip with his latest
that's
injury?
Right. Just last month, reports emerged that Harrison Ford was injured on Indiana Jones 5. This injury, however, appears to have been only a minor setback as opposed to an encounter that required any updates to the production schedule. The outlet also reported that the injury of this person that got hurt occurred while filming a scene that appeared to be a parade taking place in Manhattan. Here's the scene from the film. A parade taking place in Manhattan in the late 60s in the film. So this film, the new Indiana Jones film, takes us up to the 60s,
yeah,
you know, in the past, which featured a banner in the scene. I don't think this is a spoiler, but there's a banner in the background in the scene of the new Indiana Jones movie that says, "A giant leap for mankind as made famous by the Neil Armstrong moon landing." So who knows what they're talking about there. The Sun reported the performer, whose name is not known, appeared to be involved in a chase involving Harrison Ford's character through the parade when he barges through a brass band of sailors. But the fall, which prompted the attention of the medical team, was most likely not in the script. Luckily, the stricken actor is back on his feet before too long and gave the crowd a wave to signal he's not seriously hurt, they report. Ever since Lucasfilm confirmed that the new Indiana Jones film is on the way, audiences have speculated about what the plot of the adventure could be, with reports of the late 60s setting confirming rumors that the space race would be a major theme during the outing. Joining Ford in the film are stars Mads Mikkelsen. He was from Casino Royale. He was in Doctor Strange. We're all familiar with who he is. Phoebe Waller-Bridge. And if I'm not mistaken, I think Phoebe Waller-Bridge, I think that's how you say her last name. She's British. She did the voice for the robot, Lando's robot, in Solo, the Star Wars movie. I think she did the voice for that robot. Seanette Renee Wilson is also in the cast, and they've just added, as we reported last weekend, Antonio Banderas is in the new Indiana Jones film. Where's he been?
Yeah, he's not been around.
He's kind of been missing
on the big
in
screen.
Action. Yeah.
And it first started in 1935 timeline, so now they're in the late 60s.
Right.
That's interesting.
Right. Well, then in the Crystal Skull, the one we like to ignore,
right.
took place in the 50s because it was the Russians. And
right,
stuff, so,
right, yeah. right. Him in the refrigerator avoiding a
right.
nuclear blast.
Right. But. So, and it's under the direction of James Mangold as the new director, and I think he's writing the screenplay as well. But we all know that James Mangold directed Logan.
Yeah.
Marvel, Logan. He also directed Copland with Sylvester Stallone, which is a fantastic movie. And he also directed Walk the Line, the Johnny Cash movie with Joaquin Phoenix.
Loved
he's
it.
A great director.
Yeah, that's a good
great
one.
Director. So I'm fine with him being at the helm of this Indiana Jones film. How about you?
I am, but BK, you know what's a shame? That Sean Connery passed away. We could have had him again as Indy's father, but at least they did that
right.
with River Phoenix, who also passed away way back in 93.
Right. But let's put it this way. If Sean Connery had still been alive, I doubt he would have been even able
Showing
to
up.
Act in the film.
Right.
Because he was really
frail? I didn't know
kind
that.
Kind of frail. I saw some photos of him. I think he was
oh,
pretty
okay.
frail. But, you know, it could have been a cameo.
Yeah.
Who knows? Because remember how frail Jim Backus was for the last Gilligan's Island movie on Globetrotter
Island? He'd had a stroke.
He only came in the last scene of the show, of that movie and was able to deliver a line. Then he left. But he was able to do it. Now, Harrison Ford just said, quote, "I don't really want to give them what they want to see," Ford explained to HeyYou.com last year about what they expected to see in the Indiana Jones sequel. "I want to give them something they didn't anticipate seeing. I think they're used to a degree of disappointment when you revisit. I mean, certainly the Marvel movies have made a spectacular example of success that worked the other way around. They killed it. Well, they're not going to make another Indiana Jones unless we're in a position to kill it. We want to be the best. So we've got some scheduling issues, a few script things still to do, but we're determined to get it right before we get it made." Unquote from Harrison Ford. In other words, what that means is we don't want to make another Crystal Skull film.
They listened to the fans.
Means. He did. He did listen
How novel.
To it. So Indiana Jones 5 is currently expected to be in theaters July the 29th next year, 2022. I guess they're still kind of on schedule, I guess.
They're probably going to film around Harrison Ford, yeah.
They'd have to because I think they said his injury, though, where this guy that got hurt in this story, they said his injury wasn't that bad. But I think, was it last week or week before last, we reported that Harrison Ford's injury they thought might be worse than they thought, so he may be out of action a little longer than they thought.
So you're optimistic then about this?
I'm very optimistic about this because of one name, James Mangold.
There you go.
A fresh guy coming in. I mean, he's a seasoned director already. But it's pretty bad. And I hate thinking that. I'm like, wow, really? George Lucas and Steven Spielberg have nothing to do with this? Wow, what a sigh of relief.
They both lost it, though. I hate to say that,
right,
but late in their careers, they kind of lost it.
And I have a theory about that. You want to hear what my theory on that is? When they were younger and making movies,
they were
in the
hungry.
70s and 80s, they were hungry, and they had to be creative. They had to make it work. They had to make this entertaining and good and awesome. That's
they had to make a name for themselves.
Right. But then again, they got fat. I don't mean physically. maybe George Lucas.
Yeah,
but they didn't really go, well, let's make an Indiana Jones movie. Well, you know, what should it be about? Well, let's just do it. They'll love it. We're doing it. I'm Steven Spielberg. What have I got to lose? Well, a lot. I'm sure that I think the movie was a success financially. How could it not be? It's Indiana Jones. It's got built-in success. But now when you get far away from it, everyone that was even – some people that were even involved with it went, yeah, this is not a very good Indiana Jones movie.
The problem, Barry, is they surrounded themselves with yes men.
They do.
So no one could say, that's not a good idea.
That's true.
That sort of thing.
Have you ever seen the little making of featurette of The Phantom Menace with George Lucas
right.
on the disc?
Yeah. Rick McCollum.
When Rick McCollum is in there
yeah.
talking to him,
yeah.
and he's like, yes, George, huh? Yeah,
yeah,
that's a great idea. But you got Ben Bird in there, the sound guy, and I remember one scene where George Lucas has just showed them
mm-hmm.
a few, like, several minutes of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, okay, well, I'm paraphrasing. He's like, okay, what'd you think? And Ben Burtt's looking, he's scratching his head, and he's trying to tell George Lucas diplomatically what he thought. He's like, I don't know if this works. I said, you're going from a serious scene to action and then to comedic bit within 5 minutes of everything. And he's like, I don't know sure that's working, George, or something like that. And I'm like, wow, Ben Burtt's actually not a yes man.
Ben
he's telling him
for those that don't know,
what to do.
He is a genius. He came up with the laser sound effects.
Sound
he was
effects
just tapping on coils.
Holds up telephone poles.
Telephone pole
yeah.
coils, and he came up with R2-D2's beeps, a
he
whole
did.
Language. Which
by
I didn't like.
Using electronics and baby noises for R2-D2.
Correct.
Yeah.
But only Episode 4, the very first Star Wars movie, it was renamed Episode 4, it was re-released, had original dialogue for R2-D2. They recycled that later, which irritated me, starting with
right.
The Empire Strikes Back.
Right. Well, you know it's really well done when you have an electronic robot that
talks in nothing but bleeps and bloops. Mm-hmm. But when they choose the correct sounds of bleeps and bloops, you know exactly what he's feeling. Because right. when R2 gets sad, he does that.
It's tones.
It's like it sounds like he's sad.
Yeah, exactly.
You're doing the right thing. And plus, you have 3PO to translate if you have to.
But how did Han Solo know what Chewbacca was saying, though? That's a stretch.
Because he speaks Wookiee. Let me put it this way. You know what? My dog is smarter than I am. Because, number one.
I believe that.
My dog. Thanks.
I'm doing an Alanism.
You're filling in for Alan.
I'm standing in.
My dog understands dog and what I'm saying. Because I can tell my dog what to do, and she knows what I'm saying. I can't speak dog. I can only speak English. So she speaks two languages. I only speak one. But my dog, everybody's like, I wish dogs could talk to you. I'm like, well, you know what? They really do, though. Because I can usually tell by the sounds my dog's making, how she's acting, and what she's doing, exactly what's up with her. So she is really speaking to me. I just have to listen.
It's the ultimate body language.
That's
and
right.
vocal quality.
That's right. So I'm thinking about just not talking anymore and just barking and grunting and beeping. What was the cute meme that was floating around on the internet of R2-D2? Oh, it was R2-D2. He was just standing there, you know, a little shot of him. And it says, the only character in cinematic history that had the worst dialogue. They bleeped out every word he said.
Censored him.
Great, that's right. They censored everything he said. Well, speaking of there, we're going to take a break. We're coming up on the top of the hour here. But when we come back, we're going to hear from Channel Star Wars about, speaking of Star Wars, what's going on in the Star Wars world. And I got a story about Marla Gibbs from the Jeffersons, Florence, getting her own star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. We're going to tell you where you can locate some Marvel locations in Atlanta. If you're ever in Atlanta, you want to visit Loki's, the TVA headquarters in it, of Loki, the TV show Loki. We'll tell you where you can find it if you happen to be in town. And on this day in history, and we just got all kinds of stuff going on. Game of Thrones actress is going to be in the Marvel Universe, and Chance will have his segment at the bottom of the next hour when we come back. Might even have a quiz for Chance, too, from a MeTV quiz, since Alan isn't here, when we come back. And Chance will ace it because he's really good on dates and stuff like that. And I found an old TV. I found an old TV in a thrift store. I'll tell you about that when we come back, too. Stand by for that. It's BK on the air.
We'll return after these messages.
Get ready for a new look to ABC's All-Star Saturday. Starting with that cool cat, the Pink Panthers.
We'll tear them apart.
And Fang Face. Then it's the new 90-minute challenge of the Super Friends. Followed by everybody's favorite, Scooby's All-Stars, starting Saturday.
Hi, is Barbara ready?
I think you have time for a bite.
Your kitchen, it's thick and rich.
Doesn't your mom buy you Heinz?
No. Why?
Just taste it.
I'm not.
Thick, rich Heinz ketchup. The taste that's worth the wait.
Stand by to receive our transmission.
Welcome to Star Wars Extra, bringing you the latest from the Star Wars galaxy. I'm your host, Mike Mann.
Hello there.
After the credits for the finale of Mandalorian Season 2, fans exploded with excitement at the announcement of the upcoming The Book of Boba Fett, which will debut December of this year. Shortly after, the powers that be disclosed that Season 3 of The Mandalorian would begin filming after the aforementioned title was complete. And that brings us to now. This week, ACS, a cinematography news site, broke the news that indeed filming has commenced for Mandalorian Season 3. Additionally, Katie Sackhoff recently posted a now-expired story to Instagram about getting a Tauntaun 19 test so she could start working on her next project. While, yes, this could lead to any role imaginable, one of the most prominent roles would be her reprisal of Bo-Katan. While this news has neither been denied or confirmed by Lucasfilm or Disney, having Season 3 released shortly after the end of The Book of Boba Fett would help set up the Star Wars universe in a very Marvel way, and that there will almost always be new Star Wars content being released. If the report holds substance, The Mandalorian Season 3 would debut in 2022. All fans can do is eagerly await further details.
I've heard your voice thousands of times.
Mine might be the last one you hear.
Also this week, Star Wars released the first official poster for the upcoming Star Wars Galactic Star Cruiser Immersive Hotel. The storytelling experience is a two-night all-inclusive adventure where guests live out their very own Star Wars adventure. The poster release features various characters, both adult and children, implying that guests can choose their character type, which will have its own unique adventure. The release also features the Halcyon, the ship in which guests are traveling on, a family at the Crown of Corellia dining room, and the noticeable spires from the Black Spire Outpost, as guests will also land on Batuu in Disney parks. The Star Wars Galactic Star Cruiser Story Living Experience will open in 2022 at Disney parks, while the promotional poster is currently available for viewing online.
Impressive. Most impressive.
And finally this week, the highly detailed yet unofficial announcement was made that Princess Leia will be recast. Unbelievable? Unthinkable? Worry not, fellow Star Wars fans. Reports have been stating that Vivian Lyer Blair will be portraying young Princess Leia in the upcoming Obi-Wan Kenobi series. This much-anticipated story is said to be set roughly 10 years after the Clone Wars, making Luke and Leia 9 years old. The addition of Leia to the Obi-Wan Kenobi series could ultimately lead to future appearances for this character as well. The Obi-Wan Kenobi series is currently filming and will stream on Disney Plus in 2022.
What? Aw, oh, hell no. Hold up. Huh? Oh, okay.
That's all the time we have. Don't forget to check out our Star Wars Extra podcast, streaming on Anchor and Spotify. Also, tune back in next week for all the latest and greatest in Star Wars. For Star Wars Extra, I'm Mike Mann. And now back to my Skywalker, BK on the air.
Thank you, Mike Mann, for that trip into a long time ago into a galaxy far, far away. Channel Star Wars, Star Wars Extra. We appreciate them being with us every Saturday. Well, you know, somebody.
Every Saturday?
Every Saturday. Well, I say that just to sound good.
May I ask you a quick Star Wars question?
Oh, a quick Star Wars question.
Really quick. Have you and Mrs. BK ever been to Star Wars Galaxy's Edge at Disney Hollywood Studios in Orlando?
On our list.
Me either. I want to walk in that Millennium Falcon.
Well, I hear that it's a totally immersive experience. You've been to Universal to Harry Potter World, right?
Yeah.
I hear it's just like that, taken to the nth degree, though. Like when you're at the Wizarding World of Harry Potter, you really think you're there when you're walking around there, because everyone's in costume and in character. You walk into the castle. It's all immersive. The wand shop, the three broomsticks where you can go eat. Mm-hmm. I hear this is just the same, only more, but with Star Wars.
And you've told me off air you guys both prefer Universal Studios theme park.
My wife's a Disney nut. She's a Disney fan.
Corrected.
And I haven't been to Disney since the late 90s or the early 2000s. It's been a long time since I've been to Disney. So when we go there, we're going to wait till things die down a little bit. I don't think the mask mandate is in place anymore. It may or may not be, but I'm not going to a park if I have to wear a mask. It's just me. I just don't like having to breathe when you're riding a
especially
ride.
Especially in the summertime.
Yeah, because it gets hot and you get excited and you start to breathe hard and stuff. And
that's
not
a commentary, folks.
Kind of a related story that this week, Universal's wait time to get into the park, I noticed, was 2+ hours just at the gate to get in at Universal.
You need a fast
pass. That's a long time. No, you got to buy. Yeah, I don't know how they can make a fast pass.
To compensate for that wait time to get in the gate.
Well, a classic television actress got her star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame this week.
Want me to fix lunch now?
We're still talking, dear.
Can't you talk over lunch? I'm hungry.
Not yet, Lawrence.
Well, talk faster, will you?
See? She's bossy. I thought that was very good. There's nothing wrong with her wanting to fix lunch. And when I said no, she obeyed my order right away.
How about if I start without y'all? My stomach's so empty, it's beginning to echo.
Will you get back in the kitchen?
I'm getting.
Marla Gibbs from the Jeffersons. 90,
love her.
She's 90 years old, and she received her star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame either yesterday or day before yesterday.
On Tuesday, July 20th.
Is this
2021.
Week. Cindy Henderson from USA Today has the story that I have right here. She's best known for portraying Florence Johnston, you heard right there in the Jeffersons, during her illustrious acting career that spans 5 decades. And she's doing well following an incident at her Hollywood Walk of Fame unveiling. We'll expound on that here in just a moment. The 90-year-old actress appeared to faint while giving a speech during her Hollywood Walk of Fame ceremony due to the scorching Los Angeles heat. Quote, Marla was overwhelmed with all the love and support she received and got overheated, her agent Gary Purdy said in a statement to USA Today on Wednesday. She just needed a few minutes to cool down, unquote. The actress
rejoined the ceremony shortly after and was seated, while the 2,678th star is the one that she got on the Hollywood Walk of Fame was unveiled in her honor. Gibbs' star was awarded in the television category and installed partially by her great-great-grandchildren. Her great-grandchild Angela revealed on an Instagram post. Norman Lear, the creator of the Jeffersons, and Tisha Campbell also attended the ceremony. Gibbs is best known for playing Maid Florence Johnston on the Jeffersons from 1975 to 1985, which were aired on the CBS network. The role earned her five Emmy nominations for supporting actress in a comedy. Her other acting credits include 227, Martin, and the 2000 film The Visit. She also starred in her own spinoff show, people might forget this, called Checking In. It's an American sitcom television series and a spinoff of The Jeffersons that aired only for four episodes on CBS from April 9th to April 30th back in 1981, which was 40 years ago.
Wow. And the seventh
season finale of The Jeffersons, Florence's new job, The Jeffersons made Florence, accepted the job to become the executive housekeeper of the fictional St. Frederick Hotel in New York City. That was the show, Checking In. The series followed Florence's misadventures at the hotel with her co-workers. Larry Linville from MASH was in that show. Begin there. We're going to take a break. We'll be back.
No breakfast, Mom. My turn to feed the class turtle. Cinnamon donuts.
The traffic's all tied up. I'll get coffee later. Do I smell crumb cakes?
Funny how people with no time for breakfast often find time when breakfast means Hostess. Like Hostess crumb cakes. Fresh from the Hostess Breakfast Bake Shop in your store.
May I have my donut now?
Sure, the turtle can wait.
Keep 'em home for breakfast with Hostess.
Light, the toy that lets you create beautiful pictures with light.
Light.
Work with colorful pegs that glow with light, light bulb not included. Make people, animals, things, and with refills, Bugs Bunny or Bozo the Clown. You can make lots of pretty pictures with Light Bright from Hasbro.
It is offensive. Fortunately, taste is irrelevant.
You are listening to BK on the Air on AM 1450, FM 100.3, and online on the Tunein radio app. Now, back to a guy who'll make you feel really young, mostly because he's so old. It's BK on the Air.
We're back. It's BK on the Air here. By the way, listen, I want to tell you this first, and I'll follow up with it later. I was at a thrift store this week. Sometimes I go to the thrift store, I'm looking for stuff, and I saw on the shelf, there's an old, you know, Chance, how you see old defunct computers and appliances that people don't want anymore because they're out of date.
That's the section I go to first, the electronics section.
They're out of date. No one uses the antiquated electronics anymore. Well, I saw this old black and white TV that was just sitting over there on the shelf, and it had, I don't know, it was an old Bradford or Zenith. I haven't really looked at the name brand, but it had a pair of rabbit ears on it. And I'm like, okay, and I started to walk away. I saw a little
An antenna.
An antenna for the great millennials that don't know what that is.
Or Jenerson's ears.
It had a little arc of electricity in between it. Remember like how the Frankenstein things look?
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, what happened? Has that thing got a short in it or whatever? And I looked and it wasn't even plugged in. I'm like, was it one of those portable TVs that has a battery in it? And I couldn't find it because it was like an early 70s TV. I couldn't tell it wasn't one of those because it was too early for those, I guess. So I just said, well, you know what? I've been looking for something like this. I think I'll just buy it and take it home and put it on the shelf because I have some old AM transistor radios that I'm fascinated with, the old AM radios from the late 50s all the way to the 70s that just had the AM pocket radios. I love those. Well, I bought it, took it home, and I was fooling around with the, you know how you clunk, 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 clunk the channels and stuff, and you just flip the switch on. Well, I flipped the switch on, just the big old clunky on-off switch.
UHF, VHF.
But I turned the power switch on, and it came on, and it played like All in the Family. It came on, Archie and Edith started singing, and I'm like, what's going on here? I don't even know what's going on here. Because I had it plugged in, but I'm like, why is it playing this? Yeah. But so anyway. So I'm thinking, I tried it this morning at home, and it played a cartoon title sequence. So here's what I did. Later on in the program today, I've got it right here in the studio. It's sitting right behind us. And I'm just going to leave it in here. I'm going to leave this television in here in the studio. Hopefully nobody will mess with it. And every Saturday, I'm going to take a segment and just turn it on Saturday and just see what it plays. Because it seems to be playing
themes from cartoons from the 70s from whatever year. I guess it's receiving signals from the past or something. It's a Twilight Zone. I'm a little scared of it, to be quite honest. I don't know if it's witchcraft or whatever, but I'm going to take advantage of it and just turn it on later. I'm going to turn the switch on and hook it up through the
board.
You're
braver than I am. I'm afraid to be a fire hazard, dude, with these.
I'll take my chances. Hey, if it's fire hazard and we break out in a fire, we'll make the news.
Damn.
People will talk about us. So I'll play that later.
Okay.
And see what happens. Right. It may play a Saturday morning cartoon theme. It may not. I don't know.
I got to interject something real quick. Chance Bartels here filling in for Alan Sanders, keeping his seat warm. Remember,
but you're here anyway, so you're not really filling in.
I'm in his seat with a good mic.
Yeah. Is it warm still?
I'm keeping it warm, not with natural gas, I might add.
It's warm from Walt earlier.
Yeah. But I want to say, remember in WandaVision, I liked how they showed an analog TV like the one you're describing.
Right.
With the tube, and that's how they could tune in to whatever Wanda was conjuring up in that world.
Anyway,
if you don't know WandaVision, you don't know what the heck I'm talking about. But those that have seen it know exactly what I'm talking
about. If they're a regular listener to this show, I'm sure they know what WandaVision is.
I think it was episode 3 of WandaVision or 4.
And did you hear about the director of WandaVision and some of the production team that they are working on the new Star Trek film? So I'm like, wow, that makes me feel good.
WandaVision was so creative.
That Marvel people,
even if you're not a Marvel guy or gal, you'll dig it, and it's really good.
That's a perfect segue to what I want to go into right now. I have a story here which is cool. As we well know, a lot of things are filming in Georgia, filming in Atlanta. A lot of Marvel productions are filmed here in Georgia. In fact, the last three shows, WandaVision, Falcon and the Winter Soldier, and Loki, all filmed right here in Atlanta. For the odd time that they went on location somewhere else, maybe. But it was all filmed here in Georgia, either at studios or outside.
I'd love to be on a Marvel set.
Well, here's the story. If you're ever in Atlanta, check this out and listen up. Loki's TVA headquarters is a real hotel in Atlanta, Georgia. It's the greatest dream of many a fan to step into the world of the story they most love. In other words, there are plenty of people out there who'd give anything to live in the MCU. I know I'd love to do that. I'd like to live in the MCU. I'd love to live the Star Wars world, Harry Potter, any of that. Now, once inside, there are good plenty landmarks a touring fan would like to visit. Stark Tower, sure. All of Wakanda. Well, yeah, of course. Westview, if you could guarantee a safe trip back out, of course. Alas, we may never quite win the chance to set foot inside the Sanctum Sanctorium or cross the Bifrost Bridge from Thor. However, there's at least one newly minted MCU locale that welcomes real-world visitors on the regular. If you're within traveling distance of Atlanta, and we're right here in Georgia, just north of Atlanta, here in Cartersville at WBHF, you can visit Loki's Time Variance Authority headquarters anytime you wish, and it won't even entail being apprehended by a dimension-hopping hunter, by the way. In real life, the TVA headquarters is, in fact, the Atlanta Marriott Marquis Hotel in Atlanta. Perhaps it'd be more appropriate to say that the Atlanta Marriott Marquis is the TVA's variant in our reality. However, there is no swamp reptile compliment to Tom Hiddleston here. The interior of the hotel evidently boasts the sci-fi veneer that enlivened the backdrop of the Disney Plus series. Yeah, when you watch and you see the TVA, it's actually the Atlanta Marriott, but it's digitally enhanced behind it to make it look cavernous and gigantic, though. But they use the lobby area of the Atlanta Marriott.
Yeah.
Now, the building's located at 265 Peachtree Center Avenue, Northeast in downtown Atlanta. Unlike on Loki, it's not overrun by gear-clad hunters, statues honoring other world supremacies, or sentient cartoon clocks. It's simply a neat-looking hotel situated in the part of the country where Marvel hosts a lot of its productions, right here in Georgia. So perhaps one day, if you're so inclined, you can spend a night in the would-be TVA. Maybe you'll get to live out your dreams of unraveling the mysteries of the sacred timeline, or maybe you'll get pruned. Traveling is always a crapshoot one way or the other. Now, other locations here in Atlanta are included but are not limited to. There's a lot more different locations than what I'm going to bring up, but these are specific right here. Listen to these. Now, for Captain America Civil War, filmmakers used a crop shot of the top of the Porsche Experience building, which is in South Atlanta, not too far from the airport down in South Atlanta. And it's a test driving attraction down by the airport in Atlanta. You know, when you see the Avengers headquarters and the big A Avengers on the side, that's the Porsche building in Atlanta. That's the South Porsche building.
Wear a bulletproof vest if you go there.
Yeah, and watch out for Quinjets landing, too, so look out. So, and for the funny parking lot scene where Ant-Man is starstruck by Captain America in Captain America
Civil War, you remember that, is the AT&T Midtown Garage. I mean, it's just a parking garage. It looks like any other parking garage. It's where they filmed at. Here's another local one for us. The opening shot. Now, quite a bit of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 was filmed right here in Cartersville surrounding our radio station here. But the opening shot of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, in which you see Star-Lord, Star-Lord's dad, Kurt Russell, riding in the car with Star-Lord's mother in the past, listening to Brandy
in
by Looking Glass. Yeah, they're driving along, and the camera pans back, and we've said this before, pans back from the car. It's a big drone helicopter shot because they pan back up in the air, and you see them driving down this road, and in the distance, you see a power plant in the distance. Well, that's right here in New Harley, just west of us here from Cartersville. That's Georgia Power Plant Bowen out there, and that's the road. And when Mrs. BK and I went out and found the exact road, and we drove the same road shot that they're doing in the film. We just went out there and we turned Brandy on. We played Brandy on Sirius XM.
The song Brandy.
We found the song and played it as we were driving down, and we kind of reacted that song.
Yeah.
We reenacted that scene as we were driving our car down that same road, and it was kind of fun. So go on the website and look, go on the internet and look up some locations in Atlanta. If you're ever in the area, you want to find out where they film some Atlanta Marvel productions. You can if you're here in the area. Now, a lot of them you can't see because
Atlanta Movie Tours. I don't know if they're back in business post-COVID. They
Right,
a
and
great
they,
job
they cover a lot touring. Of Walking Dead
they
stuff,
do.
Too, right? Down in Sonoma and Noonan, yeah.
And in downtown.
Also, if you want to check out some places, you can't see some places because a lot of places where you think they may have filmed it in Atlanta, they were, but they were on a green screen studio.
Yeah. The Atlanta Hilton Towers, if you and Mrs. BK or just you by yourself gone to the top floor, I challenge you and the listeners to do that and look down.
What building?
In the Atlanta Hilton Towers. Go up to the top and look down. In the hotel, if you have vertigo, boy... Man,
yeah, I can do that. I don't have vertigo. My sister couldn't do it, though. She has vertigo.
I would love to be in a Marvel set. And, in fact, I created a character when I was – that's another story for another time. But I created a character named Madcap who allegedly will be in a Deadpool movie.
Oh, wow. Yeah, Madcap. I remember him. Yeah.
To be honest, it was before Disney owned Marvel. I submitted a drawing, a synopsis. I called the character Happy.
Right.
And it was completely no credit to me. There was a contest. I'll tell the story another time.
Well,
but
you posted it on your Nostalgic Pod Blast, so people can see that article.
In the Facebook
you posted
group
on there too.
Yeah.
Well, Marvel certainly. I mean, we have Burt Reynolds and who's the guy that worked with Burt Reynolds to bring film to Georgia? Who's the guy?
Ed
Spivey. We have those guys to thank for actually jump-starting that.
And
back
he's
in
deceased.
Back in the 70s.
They're both deceased, of course.
Yeah, back in the 70s.
Sadly.
I mean, with Deliverance and Smoking the Bandit.
Yeah.
And Burt filmed Sharky's Machine, his cop movie, down in 1981. Something happened with Bird. I don't know what it was to make him mad. He left Georgia and never came back. Somebody made him mad, and he didn't film anything else.
Filming Sharky's Machine, he got mad.
Was that what it was? They didn't want him to something
happen.
Have
you been up in the Sundial Hotel? You must have.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Or the what used to be is now the Westin.
The Westin.
It used to be called Peachtree Plaza,
Peachtree Plaza.
And that's where they blow Henry Silva out the window.
When I worked on Walking Dead, they showed – remember when in 2008 or 2009 there was a tornado that hit downtown, and a lot of those windows got blown out.
They did. Yeah,
and when I get
that.
Shot by Merle in the episode Guts, the second episode of season 1 of Walking Dead, you see – and it really fit apocalyptic.
You said it.
The apocalyptic mood and feel of that scene. It looked cool with the windows blown out of that thing.
So they left that.
They left it in. Yeah. Well, no, they didn't leave it in. It just hadn't been reconstructed.
But, I mean,
yet.
They hadn't fixed it.
It suited the scene.
Well, I thought it was just weird because sometimes you don't hear, I know what happens, but you don't hear quite often tornadoes running through a downtown metropolitan area.
Very
rare.
Weird. Yeah.
Which it happened once, I think, I remember seeing it happening in Chattanooga once, I think, many years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And then it happened in Atlanta here. What was that? Has that been 3 years ago now? Two or 3 years ago when that happened?
Yeah. But going up on that helicopter, though. I mean, that helicopter in the elevator is really a scary elevator.
Oh, yeah, because it's kind of on the outside of the building.
Yeah,
you know,
you're outside,
cool.
And if you are afraid of heights, boy, you're going to be terrified.
Was it the stuntman? Was it Dar Robinson?
Dar Robinson
that made that
did
fall?
The stunt in Sharky's Machine.
Yeah, and it was a great fall.
Yeah,
too, and not a lot of people liked it for some reason. But I thought Sharky's Machine was a fantastic kind of a throwback.
A dark movie.
Well, it was
gritty.
Kind of a throwback to the 50s cop, almost a film noir. Burt was trying to do there, and I thought it was a great film.
I love it.
Brian Keith was in it.
Yep. Brian Keith, Uncle Bill from Family Affair.
George Charles
Henry
Dunning.
Scylla was
Charles
a villain
Durning.
From Buck Rogers in the 25th Century.
Right. But who was their boss? Charles Durning.
Yeah, Charles
was
Durning.
In Evening Shade with him.
You got it.
Like and Celia, Rachel Ward.
Rachel Ward
was the
Doc
the
Severinsen
lead.
Did some of the music from the
he
Tonight
did,
Show.
Which
he's
was,
still alive.
Which was
by
great.
The way.
It's a good soundtrack too. Speak down there. Stand by. We got more coming up.
Hi, I'm Captain America. And I'm here to talk to you about one of the most important weapons in any soldier's arsenal. Math. As a soldier and as an Avenger, I've seen some pretty exciting things. But you know what's really exciting? Reading.
I'm running away from home. My parents are mean. Where will you go? Oh, I'm not sure, but I'll show them.
That's right. You'll show them how mean you can be.
Shipwreck!
Isn't it better to try to solve problems instead of running away from them?
I could try talking to my parents again.
Yeah, tell them how you feel. And remember, running away
leads nowhere. Now I know. And knowing is half the battle.
G.I. Joe!
Here are some words of wisdom from Mr. Know-It-All.
Freeze frame!
Hey, we're back. It's BK on the air here on AM 1450 and 100.3 FM WBHF. It's that time, yes. It's that time to take a chance with Chance Bartels. He's going to go over there and give us a freeze frame snapshot of nostalgia. Take it away, Chance.
Thank you, BK. It's time for my nostalgic news of the week. And I want to piggyback on the Marla Gibbs story about her getting her star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. Did you know she is one of three surviving cast members of the Jeffersons in terms of the opening credits? The other two being Berlinda Tolbert, who played Jenny Willis.
Which I had a crush on, by the way.
She's from North Carolina. She's a Southern gal.
Beautiful lady.
She was born in Charlotte, North Carolina. She's still alive. And believe it or not, she's in her 70s, just like Linda Carter, we'll talk about later. And the other surviving cast member besides Marla Gibbs and Berlinda Tolbert is Damon Evans. And he was the second Lionel Jefferson, because the first one, Mike Evans,
right,
had a contract dispute. And he was the first Jefferson you ever met back on All in the Family season one, because you didn't see George Jefferson until about the third season of All in the Family.
Yeah, you saw his brother.
You saw his brother, Henry.
And Mike Evans was very instrumental in creating Good Times.
That's right.
The other Norman Lear
good
show.
Factoid, yeah. Barry. And the
factoid.
The other thing that's interesting is both of the actors who played Lionel have a last name Evans. Mike Evans was the original.
Weird? Isn't that weird?
And then at the end of, I think, season two, there was a contract dispute. And so Mike Evans was replaced, but then he came back and replaced the second.
That's right.
Damon, who is still alive.
I always preferred the second, the original Lionel. He was funny.
And I always loved Florence. And she got a big belly laugh in her very first episode where she was a hired maid.
That's right.
And she goes, "Well, how come we ever came and nobody told me?" And the audience
it was a live audience, not a laugh track.
Remember that? Laugh.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I love The Jeffersons. One of my favorite shows.
Jackie Gleason used to say, the best way you can gauge how funny your comedy is do it in front of live people.
That's right.
If you put canned laughter in, how's anybody going to know it's funny
That's
or not?
That's right. And you know, and I'm a big proponent of DVDs and Blu-rays versus streaming because the streaming giveth and the streaming service taketh away.
It does, yeah.
So I bought like all 11 seasons of The Jeffersons for like, it's cheap. It's like $40 online box set, uncut.
Yeah.
But and then the last thing I wanted to say about The Jeffersons was one of my favorite episodes pertaining to Florence, Marla Gibbs' Florence, was the one with Billy Dee Williams, who has a Star Wars tie-in. Of course, he was Lando Calrissian in The Empire Strikes Back.
You pirate?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And she didn't believe it was him. Anyway,
right.
It was a funny episode.
Right. He's played himself.
So moving on, we have another birthday today. Canadian-born actress and Best Supporting Actress Oscar winner Anna Paquin from The Piano and Rogue from the X-Men movies is 39 years old today. And tomorrow, July 25th, 2021, the late David Bowie's wife and supermodel Iman, I-M-A-N, Iman, turns 66. Now, Barry, we know her from Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country, as the metamorph Martia.
And you know what always bugged me in Star Trek VI when she shapeshifts and Kirk acts like he's never seen a shapeshifter before? He goes, "Oh, shapeshifter, I thought you were mythical." I'm like, no, you encountered two
Whom
of them on the
gods
original
Destroy season.
You encountered
three.
A couple of them on the old show. Come on. You remember that?
Who was in Whom God Destroyed was Batgirl. It was a season after
Yvonne
Batgirl was canceled.
Craig. Yeah.
Yvonne Craig played the Green Girl. Eddie Murphy did a joke I can't say over the air.
No, you can't do that one. You can do it on the podcast, though.
Yeah. Okay. So. Well, remember that? Eddie Murphy goes, remember the one when Kirk blanked that green blank? That's
right.
All I can say.
And also, the other thing I remember seeing Iman in was the Kevin Costner movie, No Way Out.
Right.
Do you remember that where she played?
Of course.
That was really cool.
And she was David Bowie's wife.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so speaking of 1991, Star Trek, The Undiscovered Country. Remember the extended version that was released on home video in 1992? Now, those extra scenes really made the movie a lot better and more coherent, particularly the end and the assassination attempt scene.
You know, I say I will have to disagree with you there, because when they go, oh, Admiral Cartwright, and they just show the black and white flashbacks, I'm like, I didn't need that. I knew exactly who it was and what they were doing.
The hell you say, BK?
But I did like the part where they included the guy from Benson, Rene Arbazawa, whatever his name is, yep, where he comes in to tell him about the rescue mission they want to do. That was edited out, but that was a good addition. But now, I thought the little flashback scene of them at the end was very television-ish.
We've got to talk about, and this is something everyone can relate to, whether you're a Trekker, Trekkie, or not, Kim Cattrall.
She
played,
yeah,
Lieutenant Valeris, and she reprised her howling moaning that she had done previously in the 1981 movie Porky's as Honeywell, when Spock does a mind meld with her to verify that she's not a spy.
Sort of, yeah. She kind of
did. But I love that much.
Yeah.
I can't, but I'll embarrass myself trying to do that. But anyway, she had a great moan, and also I loved her in Police Academy, and of course Sex and the City as Samantha. And she was in, listen.
What was the name of that show she was in?
Sex and the City.
Right. Why do people call it Sex in the City as a mistake? I don't know why they do that. It's weird.
Did I say it wrong?
No, you didn't, but people do.
Really? Well, anyway, and she was also in a good episode of The Incredible Hulk, where she learned that David Banner's true identity as the creature in an episode titled Kindred Spirits from season 2 of that show.
Here's a tie-in for you. I used to be friends with a guy, a coworker, that dated her way back when, before she was a star.
Was,
and he told her all about it. And he wasn't lying. He proved he had sexy photos with her. And I'm like, oh, you dated Kim Cattrall. Good job.
I got to tone it down. But now Monday, July 26th, Mick Jagger is 78 years young. And also, here's a good one for you. Monday, Sandra Bullock is, are you ready for this? 57. And I have an 8x10 glossy of her from an early acting job she did in 1989 in the Bionic Showdown movie, and she played the Bionic girl, Kate Mason.
First thing I saw her in.
Yeah. And I have a publicity shot with her, and it has Lindsay Wagner in it as Jamie Summers and the late Richard Anderson, Oscar Goldman. We can rebuild him.
Another lady who is not aging. She's not aging at all.
And I have it signed by Richard Anderson, Lindsay Wagner, and I need to have Sandra Bullock. I don't know. Give me advice on how I can get Sandra Bullock to sign that and complete the trifecta.
I don't know. Stalker, maybe? I don't know. No, don't do that. I'm sorry. No, I don't know how. She's a pretty big star, so I think she would be really hard to get.
I'm gonna just quickly say that last week I told the story about Felice Sampler dying on July 1st. Well, I mentioned she was in a couple T.J. Hooker episodes. Well, I looked at my DVR. And the only DVR episode I have with T.J. Hooker was one of the ones she was in called Sleigh Ride. Anyway, I thought that was weird. And I recorded that back in 2016. I still haven't watched it. Now, also, I want to say it's time for my nostalgic word or expression of the week. Here it is. I'll be there with bells on.
With bells on.
I'll be there with bells on. It's a Southern expression. This expression means that a person, mostly a female, is ready to celebrate eagerly, as in, of course I'll come. I'll be there with bells on.
Unless you're a farmer and you say, I'll be there with bales on.
Bales on.
Bales of hay.
This metaphoric expression alludes to decorating oneself or one's clothing with little bells for some special performance or occasion.
And who hasn't done that?
This phrase is frequently used in reply to a party invitation, and the common format in that case is to indicate one's enthusiasm with, I'll be there with bells on. And the phrase originated in the late 19th, early 20th centuries, and most of the early citations of it suggest a U.S. origin. The first record of it that I have is found in print, which I doubt is its earliest usage, is in F. Scott Fitzgerald's The Beautiful and the Damned from 1922. And the line, all righty, I'll be there with bells. And the phrase is paralleled in the U.K. by with knobs on. I'll be there with knobs on.
Really? I didn't know
with
that.
With additional ornament.
Really?
Now,
so in UK it's knobs, here it's bells.
That's right. Now,
All right.
Internet BS of the week. Have you seen these videos of Generation Zers or Millennials, and it says, this is the first time they're watching Jaws or an iconic movie like that?
Oh, yeah, or any
they're
of them,
so
yeah.
Dumb. Well,
yeah.
The dumb thing, Barry, is that they're so phony, but yet they get hundreds of thousands of views, and I think they're manufactured views.
I hope they are, because I don't watch them.
The commentary is so underwhelming. Like for instance, this girl will be watching Jaws, she'll go, oh, I didn't expect that. You know, that's the big commentary.
Right.
And I think that's got to be bogus views.
Number one, I'm not interested in watching maybe a millennial watch Jaws for the first time. I don't know if I'm that interested in watching somebody doing that. Now, it's funny to see the little kids. Sometimes they post videos of little kids watching Star Wars and Empire Strikes Back for the first time and hearing Darth Vader say, "I am your father," and not knowing it till then and watching the little kids' reaction.
That's not genuine.
Some of it's some of it might.
Let me believe
some of it's genuine. Come on, just let me believe
it. And a Facebook bot for a run out of time censored a value member of my nostalgic Podblast Facebook group. I had posted a photo of Stripes, the Bill Murray comedy that turns 40.
I remember
and
that.
The person recited a line when he commented in Facebook, and the line, I'll have to censor it, is, "Russians are sissies." And Facebook deleted the line and suspended the guy.
Wow. Yeah. Well, now, by the way, I know you.
Go ahead.
I know you got
internet.
You're coming up to talk. You're going to talk about Linda Carter when we come back.
Yeah.
And hold your other thing that you were going to do, and just hold on to your
last
two things.
Okay.
Yeah, and your WBHF birthday thing. I know you want to talk about that. Hold on to that. We're going to take a break because we're running over here a little bit. Let's take a break. When we come back, we'll finish up with your segment. It's BK on the air.
And now these messages.
Lasers ready.
The Battle of Galactica has begun. Where are the humans?
They are on the Universal Studios tour at the collapsing bridge and suspect nothing.
We will capture them.
In the doomed glacier expedition.
We will torture them.
At the shark.
We will annihilate them.
They are here.
The Battle of Galactica has begun. At the Universal Studios tour.
Friday, Wonder Woman shatters a hitman's disguise. Then, incredible suspense as a massive earthquake threatens a nuclear explosion. And the Incredible Hulk faces the toughest test of his life. Friday, starting at 8, 7 Central Mountain Time.
Tomorrow on CBS.
I was made for loving you. That's not Kiss, by the way, if you hadn't already guessed. That's Linda Carter singing her version of I Was Made for Loving You by Kiss. They're on one of the variety shows she did back in the mid or late 70s there. It's a nice video to look at, but maybe not to listen to. I don't know. And all the guys are dancing around her with their Kiss costumes on.
Good Lord.
Truly wonderful 70s TV. Fits right along with the Brady Bunch Variety Hour, which was never should have been made.
Only six episodes of that.
Yeah, for good reason. Yeah, and Sherwood Schwartz had nothing to do with it.
That's good reason,
too, by the way. We play that because we're going to go over to Chance. He's going to finish up his segment by talking a little bit about Linda Carter, whose birthday is today, and another kind of a birthday last weekend.
She is 70 years young today, and she looks fantastic. I love Linda Carter, always loved Wonder Woman. And I don't know if it's streaming. If it is streaming, it'll be on HBO Max, the classic Wonder Woman series. Oh, man, her singing Kiss. And that ties into something we said earlier today offline. Remember how shocking it was when Kiss removed their makeup and
licked it up? It was shocking.
Yeah.
And when I look back on it now, I think they should have never done that.
Right.
And I know it was a gimmick because they weren't all that popular at the time. No. They needed something to bring them back into the spotlight, and that was it.
They did it. Now, shame on me last week. I didn't mention that last Saturday was the 75th anniversary of the powerful WBHF.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe. I suggest we use it.
That's right. We do use it every Saturday from
So happy 10 birthday, WBHF. That's rare. 75 years.
And we're not even round like a Death Star. We're like square. Square building.
I've no doubt BHF will be around to see 100. The 100th anniversary.
Let's hope so.
I'm going to wrap up here my segment that ran long. My nostalgic snack of the week, cherry Tic Tacs.
And I never had cherry Tic Tacs.
Oh, man, I love these sugary one-calorie treats since I was 8 years old. The problem is you can't find them anywhere anymore.
I don't mind eating cherries, but sometimes cherry-flavored always tasted kind of artificial to me. I don't know why.
Do you like the orange Tic Tacs?
Orange Tic Tacs are great. The white ones are good. All the other fruit flavors are great. Yeah.
I distinctly remember a split case with a barrier in the middle of a Tic Tac pack. Hey, that rhymes. That separated the cherry Tic Tacs from the berry Tic Tacs. And then they made one with cherry and orange split down the middle. Now, everyone knows that orange Tic Tacs still exist. But to my surprise, one Christmas, my sweet sister gave me an entire brick of cherry Tic Tac packs. I was so psyched. And she found them on, guess where, Amazon.
Wow, that's cool.
Does anyone else remember the cherry Tic Tac snack? They were great.
I remember Hunt's snack pack of pudding. Those are great growing up as a kid. I love those.
Yeah.
There's only one Tic Tac, the original mouthwag.
Daddy bought me the best mints money can buy. But nothing matches the whack of a Tic Tac.
I drifted for a while. Lozenges, breath mints, but you can't beat the old whack.
There are lots of substitutions, but there's only one taste sensation like Tic Tac, the original mouthwag.
Now there's a Tic Tac with berry on one side and cherry on the other. A Tic Tac double whack pack.
Back to you, BK. That's all I've got this week.
Well, let's do On This Day in History, because I didn't do that earlier because we're kind of messed up in the beginning of the program. I was going to do an MeTV quiz, but I don't know that we're going to get to it today. We may do that next weekend, and it might be
fun. We'll never get to that quiz. We've been trying to do that quiz for 8 weeks.
That's okay. That happens on this show. It really does. July the 24th, that's today. 1952, the movie High Noon premiered on This Day in History with Gary Cooper. Some say Outland with Sean Connery is a remake of High Noon in space, and it really was. On This Day in History, 1965, Bob Dylan released Like a Rolling Stone, Like a Rolling Stone. 1969. My sister was born in March in 1969, but also on this day in history, July the 4th, Apollo 11 returned to Earth safely on this day in history. A movie premiere, 1974, Death Wish, on this day in history, based on the novel by Brian Garfield, directed by Michael Winner, and starring Charles Bronson, is released in the U.S. on this day in history. And today, 40 years ago, 1981, Raiders of the Lost Ark reclaimed its number one spot in its sixth week of release. I mean, it had been out 6 weeks, dropped out of number one, then went back to number one on this day in history, 40 years ago, 1981. Today in 1982, on this day in history, July the 24th, the single Eye of the Tiger by Survivor from Rocky III, from the soundtrack, starts a six-week run at number one. It was number one for 6 weeks on the Billboard charts, and it won a Grammy for Best Rock Performance.
You sure it wasn't the Scorpions that sang that?
They sound
thought
it sounds like
they
them.
Sound alike.
Good old. It might have been the Scorpions under another name. Who knows? Survivor. They may have been. Another movie premiere on this date. Not so great a film. Could have been better. But 1987, Superman IV, the Quest for Peace. The I don't know what in the world made Warner Brothers let Canon Films take over.
They were the ninja masters at the time. Yeah. They made all these ninja
Golden
movies.
Golden Globus guys produced a Superman movie because they cheapened out on every special effect.
Worse than
they
Dino
could.
De Laurentiis.
Story was a good, interesting story, but it wasn't executed very well. And on this day in history, 1998, Saving Private Ryan premiered on this date. Steven Spielberg film with Tom Hanks. Man, if you haven't seen Saving Private Ryan,
Ryan's Privates?
No, that's the other film.
Saving Ryan's Privates?
That's not Spielberg's film. Another one. Birthdays on this day. Today's Amelia Earhart's birthday. American aviator, the first woman to fly solo across the Atlantic. She died in 1939. It's director Peter Yates' birthday. He directed such films as Breaking Away, Bullet with Steve McQueen, and the fantasy film in the early 80s, Crawl.
I forgot about Breaking Away. The cycling movie.
Right.
The cyclists. Like Tour de France.
He died in 2011. Mark Goddard from Lost in Space. Don West. It's his birthday today from Lost in Space. Chance is a big Lost in Space fan. Irwin Allen. Today is comedian Ruth Buzzi's birthday today. Laugh-In, Margie, that girl. She's been all over the place. What was the show she did on Saturday with
Far Out Space Nuts with Jim Neighbors? It was Gomer Pyle.
It wasn't Far Out Space Nuts. That was the Bob Denver show. It was The Lost Saucer.
The Lost Saucer. I think I'm right. Let me look it up.
I think Far Out Space Nuts was Bob Denver and Chuck McCann on CBS was that show. But I think it was The Lost Saucer with him and
I like that theme, by the way. I wish we had that queued up.
Jim,
put it in post-production.
Jim Neighbors.
That's a good
was The Lost
Far
Saucer.
Out Space Nuts. Yep, you are correct.
So it was The Lost Saucer?
The Far Out Space Nuts had Bob Denver.
Right, but yep. I think Ruth Buzzi and Jim Neighbor were in The Lost Saucer. It was a fun space show. Robert Hayes, actor from Airplane, Starman, and Scandalous, is his birthday today. And today is...
He had a drinking problem.
Marvin the Martian's birthday from Warner Brothers. He was created by Chuck Jones and Michael Maltese. He first debuted in a short called Hair Devil Hair with Bugs Bunny. And as Chance, you heard from Chance, it's Linda Carter's birthday today as well. Today is National Tequila Day. I know Alan could celebrate that.
Tequila!
It's National Drive-Thru Day. We could do that on the way home, go through a drive-thru somewhere.
No, I want a margarita.
Well, is there a drive-through margarita place that you can do? Combine them both. Today is National Cousins Day. We are nostalgic cousins.
We are.
So it's National Cousins Day. And it being your birthday, it's National Amelia Earhart's day today, too.
So it ties into Harrison Ford crashing his plane.
How cool
it all comes full circle.
How cool is it that it's her? Yeah, but did she crash or did aliens abduct her? They don't
aliens.
Really,
I choose to believe aliens.
They don't really know. But I've got this little TV over here. Let me turn it on. I don't have much time. Let me turn this TV on that I bought from the thrift store and see what it plays here. Let me turn the switch on. It takes a second for it to
It's got to warm up.
It's Saturday, so it's got to be a Saturday show that it plays. Yeah, Josie and the Pussycats is playing on the TV. That's great. I can't believe this TV is playing all these.
Aren't you scared?
No, I think you just think it's cool. I don't care if it's witchcraft.
You know who's singing that, don't you?
I'll do that. Is that
Cheryl Ladd?
Cheryl Ladd, yeah. She didn't do the voices on the show, but she did the singing, interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, but she like Linda Carter, has aged very gracefully.
She has, and so has Jacqueline Smith.
Oh, gosh.
I mean, what painting? Wow. They have paintings locked in the attic of them from themselves.
Jacqueline Smith and Jane Badler are my favorite TV brunettes.
Was that what you wanted to add about Cheryl Ladd when you were talking about? Okay, cool. Well, we're ticking up to the top of the hour. I want to remind everybody that this show, we run this show through a converter, and I convert it into a podcast. Every time we get off the air, I add stuff to it, take stuff out. I add some classic bits and commercials and sound effects and make us sound really good and do things to our voices and stuff when we get off the air. And I turn this into a podcast. It's the BKS Escape Pod. You can listen to it Anchor, Spotify, YouTube, SoundCloud. There's so many places like that you can listen to it. Just search for the BK on the Air podcast and it'll tell you all the places that you would be able to listen to it. You can like and subscribe as you wish. We hope you do. On YouTube and listen to it on YouTube that way. But we do turn it into a podcast. And you also listen, tell everybody right quick where they can hear
you. The Nostalgic Podblast YouTube and Facebook group. Join it today. The Nostalgic Podblast. And also Cheryl Ladd, she sang the national anthem at the Super Bowl 1980.
No, I didn't know that.
Look it up on YouTube. It's fantastic.
And she's a good singer.
She's a great singer. a looker.
I think Cheryl Ladd does everything well, probably.
I featured
some of the things that we don't even know about.
I featured her singing that on my pod blast a couple times.
Well, it's glad to be here. Had a shaky start this morning, but we'll be here next week. Talking about everything. Alan will be back next week as well. We got all that going on. And also, if you want to email me, by the way, and get a hold of me, and you don't want to call live on the show, email me at bkontheair@gmail.com. I'm also on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. That's really the only three social media places and platforms I'm on. You can always send a message on YouTube as well. There's many ways to get a hold of me if you don't want to talk to me on the air every Saturday, but you can obviously do that. Thanks for being here, Chance. As a trooper, I appreciate it. Let's go get some lunch somewhere, man, and hang out. And
I want to borrow
time.
This TV of yours. This is cool.
But I don't know if I want to. I don't want to leave the studio with it. But we're going to do that every Saturday. Turn it on and see what it plays. It's BK on the Air. We'll see you on the podcast.
Give it up. Podcast Magazine presents the Hot 50 Countdown.
Hi, it's Rob Actis, host of the Podcast Magazine Hot 50 Countdown. Join me as I count them down from 50 to number one, the top 50 podcasts in the land as determined by you, the podcast fans. From true crime, society and culture, self-help, health and fitness, science, and every podcast category in between. The Hot 50 Countdown is here.
And don't forget to vote for BK on the Air as one of your favorite podcasts at podcastmagazine.com.